Well, we pick up where we left off at verse 23 of chapter 3 in Galatians. And Paul is telling us about the liberty that is provided by Jesus Christ. So verse 23. But before faith came, we were kept under guard by law, kept for the faith which would afterward be revealed. Therefore, the law was our attendant to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after faith has come, we are no longer under an attendant. Now, the faith mentioned in verse 23 as having come is, of course, faith in Jesus Christ. Although he's made the point that everyone in the Old Testament who ever was saved by faith, not the keeping of the law. Nevertheless, the specific faith referenced here is the faith in Jesus Christ. And there are two levels at work in the argument. First is from a historical perspective, just the time continuum. And if you want to glance ahead to chapter 4, verse 4, we're going to look at this next week, where he's talking about the actual act of Jesus coming to earth. You know, it's verse 4, when the fullness of time had come, and Jesus was born. So that's one aspect about the faith in Christ having come to the world. But more specifically and more relevant for all of us is he speaks of in our own personal situations when faith in Jesus Christ has come to each one of us personally. Now, verse 22, which we looked at last week, tells us that we're all confined like prisoners under sin. And we also saw last week that the purpose of the law of Moses was to make a standard that showed us our transgressions. By God putting a standard of law there, we see our guilt. And we read last week as well that in verse 21, if there had been a law, any sort of law whatsoever that could have been invented, whereby we could have been declared righteous before God, then hey, Jesus wouldn't have had to die. That would be marvelous. But the reality is that there is no such law. Law there used in an indefinite sense. Not talking about specifically the law of Moses, but any law, anything that could have come up. And so keeping that idea of law in the general sense, the principle of law. That's what he's talking about here in verse 23. That's why when I read verse 23, I didn't read the before law, because actually in the Greek it's not there. So we were kept under guard by law. The principle of law is like a prison guard, because we are in prison. So you see a similarity between law and sin there. It's important to recognize that bondage when we look to a legal relationship with God. Now, when Paul was writing to the Romans in chapter 6, having established the fact that we are under grace and we are saved by grace, he wrote, "Sin shall not have dominion over you, shall not reign over you, because you are not under law, but under grace." You see, sin has a dominion over me whenever I try to have that legal relationship, whenever I create my list of do's and don'ts. The whole principle of law leads to bondage. It's almost New Year's resolutions time. How many resolutions do people keep? They establish their do's and don'ts. This is what I'm going to do this year. This is what I'm not going to do this year. And then they find themselves in bondage, and they fail in their attempt. We cannot relate to God in such a legal way. We should not. Now, in complementary to the general principle of law that he's speaking about, we go to verse 24. Now, he's going back specifically to the law of Moses, the law, verse 24. So, on the surface, it looks like Paul's mixing his metaphors. No. He's talking about two different aspects of law. First, the general sense, which shuts us up like a prison guard. Now, he's talking about the law of Moses, and he describes it as, and I read the word attendant. I don't like tutor. Now, this is a Greek word. that spoke of a certain job. In Greek, it's a paidagogos. Now, what was a paidagogos? Our English Bibles, you get five or six translations, you'll find five or six different English translations for this one Greek word. It's an interesting word to look at. Now, this person would be in a fairly wealthy household, a slave in such a household, whose responsibility was to be the personal attendant for a child born in that house. A slave who was a personal attendant for the freeborn child in that home. Now, he had various obligations, but a primary obligation, and the way Paul's using him here, is as the one who would escort the child to school, wait for him at school. In fact, there was actually a room often set aside in a school for all of these paidagogoi who would be waiting for their various children they were responsible for, and then when school's out, they would escort them back home. That was a primary role. Not the school teacher, but an escort to school and back. Now, there were other responsibilities. There were some discipline functions that this person would have over a child. There would be some sort of review, quizzing of the child as to what they learned in school, but not as a teacher. That's not the primary purpose. That's why I don't like tutor in our translation. We don't want to take the illustration too far. The primary detail that Paul brings it up here is in this role as an escort. You see, he says the law of Moses is this escort, this attendant who brings us to Jesus Christ. The law does not teach us about Jesus Christ. You tell me where in the Ten Commandments you see anything about Jesus Christ. When you read the Ten Commandments, you don't see Jesus Christ, you don't see the cross, you don't see the glorious resurrection. What the Ten Commandments does, declares you guilty before God, declares you unrighteous before God, declares a death sentence upon you before God. And then it is necessary for a Christian to come along and share the good news, the gospel, that Jesus has come to earth. And Jesus is the way to righteousness. If you will just believe, if you will trust, and to tell you what Jesus has done. Now, he came to earth, born of a virgin, the Son of God, who walked among us and lived a perfect life and died a death that he did not deserve, but rather a death that was a substitute for the death that you and I deserve for our sins. And God accepted that death on our behalf, showing by the resurrection that we would be forgiven by putting our trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ. You see, and when that happens, we are no longer under a paidagogos. We are no longer under this person. The role was to lead us, the law of Moses, seen in this role, to lead us to such a desperate state that we find Jesus. But once we find Jesus, we no longer have any purpose for this person. We no longer have any purpose for the law, because we are free